Joining us now, not copy, as we talk about inflation, we have Ibon Foundation Executive Director Sunny Africa. Good morning, Sunny. Welcome to the program.
Hi, good morning, Sir Mike. All your viewers, Sana.
All right. So, Sunny, President Marcos saying we are not at the 6.1 inflation level, essentially disputing the findings of the Philippine Statistics Authority. He's saying we could have crossed the 4% threshold, but we are not that high. Your take on this?
I think everyone's free to dispute inflation figures, but I think it'd be better to dispute it and have alternative figures in mind. I don't think President Marcos had any such figures in mind, and he didn't actually even seem familiar with the 6.1% figure to begin with. So it's a bit perplexing. If it's a sign of how this administration will deal with bad news, outright this being dismissive about it, it's not a good sign in terms of economic management from our chief economic manager.
Is this a new phenomenon, so to speak, or is this a new thing that the president disputing the numbers provided by the official statistician with respect to inflation? Have you heard previous presidents do this?
No. That's a great question. I've never heard any president dispute the data from our statistical agencies. The most I've heard, which I think is fair, disputing certain budget items, maybe because of the timing, incompleteness. But honestly, this is the first time I've heard a sitting president complain that the official statistical agencies are providing wrong data. So I don't know. We have to hold on to science and believe in the professionalism, I think, of our statistical agencies. But again, I think if the president has alternative data, of course, it's very welcome. But in all honesty, the way he delivered his message, he just seemed to be making a knee-jerk reaction, which I think was unbecoming of the president.
You don't think he has basis for saying that?
I completely do not think so, because if he had, he would have mentioned it. It's very odd. The only semblance of an argument he made was invoking not tumawid daw sa 4%. I mean, that's a fact. That's a stated fact. We have breached 4%. And breaching 4% is not an argument for 6.1% being wrong. So I don't think he has any data at hand to dispute the 6.1% figure.
Mm-hmm. And Sunny, how did we get here? Because 6.1%, that's the highest in 3 years, right? So taking out the pandemic, that's the highest since 2018. What other factors are you looking at? Why did we get to this level?
Of course, inflation is really super complex. I mean, you're looking at structural factors and contingent factors. I think in terms of structural factors, the biggest problem is unproductive agriculture, expensive food, poor supply, import dependence. And in terms of the oil industry, it's too deregulated. We don't have any real control over domestic prices. I think those are the structural problems. Contingent, of course, even before the Ukraine crisis, we saw higher oil prices starting last year because of the reopening of the economies, the usual increase in prices near the end of the year because of heating demands in the first world countries, and then greatly aggravated by the Ukraine crisis the last few months. So it's a combination of structural problems and contingent problems. But again, we have to disagree with the president's statement that we can't do anything, there's no control. I think that kind of defeatist attitude is so unbecoming of a president of a country where so many millions are suffering right now.
Mm-hmm. And Sunny, we did also see that the peso sunk to its lowest purchasing level in 3 years. Is that a necessary consequence of the high inflation rate?
I think it's more because of the increase in interest rates in the United States. I think that's the big problem with globalized financial markets. What the United States does, it just really attracts a lot of hot money. But I also think that combines with a lot of uncertainty about emerging markets like the Philippines because of the global crisis, because of rising oil prices, and because of inflation. You put in the inflation trigger that really sucks capital out and puts pressure on exchange rates. But I think it is important to highlight, if we have the worst performing currency in Southeast Asia, there has to be some problems even within the Philippines. We can't just be dismissive and say, oh, it's happening globally, it's happening regionally because of the U.S. I think that kind of dismissiveness would not actually give us the right solutions.
Mm-hmm. But for the average consumer, this is a double whammy, so to speak, because you now have a high inflation rate, which means prices are going up, but the purchasing power of the peso is going down. So describe to us the impact of this on the average consumer.
I actually say it's a triple whammy. The average consumer is still suffering from 2 years of lockdowns. We're still suffering from a very stagnant economy. Despite the claims of economic growth being rapid, we're still 2 years behind in terms of the absolute level of the economy. We're still at 2019 levels. In terms of employment, we actually lost employment. We shed 1.5 million jobs as the last Labor Force survey. So I think consumers are facing a triple whammy. Things are expensive. They don't have incomes. Their incomes are so uncertain, erratic. The huge increase in unemployment, I think, is still a problem. And the huge increase in informal work and poorly paid work and part-time work, that actually hides how bad the jobs crisis is. Because the government may be able to claim with some credibility 3 million jobs in the last 6 years, but 95% of these jobs are part-time work. So they're not actually fairly paying work not work with fair remuneration. So facing the high prices right now from the exchange rate problems, and of course, fuel price problems, that's increasing suffering by the day. I think the urgency is there. We're just not feeling it from the current administration. I don't know, maybe they're just sort of feeling it through, but I think it's a bit too late for them to be still feeling things through.
Well, what do you mean by that? You're not seeing any sense of urgency in the current administration. What made you say that?
Well, like the inaugural address, the president made perfunctory mention of jobs and wages, but we heard nothing at all about how fast prices are increasing. We heard nothing at all about Philippine agriculture being the smallest share of GDP in the country's history. We heard nothing at all about manufacturing falling to its smallest in 70 years. Heard nothing about job creation in the last 6 years being the worst of all post-Marcos administrations. If we're not getting that grounding in the reality, it's kind of hard to expect that the next administration will be taking the necessarily difficult measures to take. And when we did hear his update from the first cabinet meeting, it was so weird. If this is meant to be the first cabinet meeting that started with an overview of the economic situation, you kind of wanted some bold measures to be outlined after that first cabinet, in the talk back after the cabinet meeting. But we didn't see that. We heard generalities, we heard some confused statements about inflation. So it's a bit worrying, actually. I mean, to be honest, it's a bit worrying for me right now.
We can go through each of the statements of the president from the inaugural address to the press con yesterday. And he did say during the inaugural address that they are presently drawing up a comprehensive, all-inclusive plan for economic transformation. Mm-hmm. Isn't that a positive thing for you?
We actually have heard a lot from the campaign team of positive stuff the last 3 to 6 months. I think it's insufficient for the government to be promising that and for it to be delivered only by the sauna. The president has been in public office for a quarter of a century, vice governor, representative, and Senate. He kind of had a good sense that in the last 6 months, his survey numbers were up. I'm pretty sure he felt that he would take the presidency. If you did have a sense of how deep the economic problems are, we would have thought that a serious president really prioritizing the socioeconomic crisis wouldn't wait to be elected to put a package together. So I think if he had so much resources to campaign, literally did spend billions of pesos, that missed a few hundred million, I think he could have spent more time, more energy on putting together that comprehensive package so we don't have to wait until the sauna for that to be delivered.
Shouldn't that have been part of the campaign promise, the economic plan, if elected president?
I think that was the most cynical aspect of the Marcos campaign. He alone among all the candidates did not even bother to come up with an economic plan. It wasn't on his campaign website. He didn't speak about it in his sorties. We did pay attention to his social media posts, the few media interviews he made. I think that does just reflect that he is coming in unprepared. He's actually coming in not that concerned. And I think it was so symbolic the way the inaugural ceremony played out. For him to be caught on camera with a very expensive watch, being sworn into office, and then coming out with an inaugural address, it was very empty, that did not have the grounding in the reality and crises. I think that says a lot about, at least for now, where his mind is in terms of the presidency and governance.
Mm-hmm. But didn't he mention infrastructure, agriculture, and climate change during the inaugural address?
Okay, to be fair, the most encouraging thing, and the only, I think, encouraging thing in the inaugural address was the talking about self-sufficiency in agriculture. I think that's quite important. Assuming he chose his words well, that's a big shift from the food security approach of past administrations, where food security means just being able to import from abroad. To talk about self-sufficiency means being able to produce for our needs. If that materializes, I think that's going to be the biggest shift in agriculture policy in the past four decades. I think it will lay the foundation for cheaper food. If you look at Vietnam right now, the reason food's so cheap in Vietnam is because for decades, they have relied on a self-sufficiency approach to agriculture. So whatever minimal price increases they're facing now, it's because they have a strong buffer in very subsidized, very efficient domestic agriculture. That's a good thing. The infrastructure, I think, is a bit dangerous. I know there's still an endorphin rush from big ticket infrastructure projects. But if you remember, the last big wave of infrastructure happened in the late 1970s. After that came economic crisis. The next wave of infrastructure spending came in the last 6 years of the Duterte administration, which actually saw economic growth slowing even before the pandemic. We saw job generation falling even before the pandemic. So I think we can't overplay infrastructure in its own terms. You have to have the complementary development of agriculture, industrial protections, industrial support. If you don't have the complementary measures, you know, having nice roads and transport infrastructure won't really be the boost economic development that we think it will be.
Mm-hmm. And let's talk about agriculture, because he's saying that that's one of his priorities. What do you make of the fact that he's taken on the role as agriculture secretary himself? Is that a sign that he's very serious about taking on that problem? Or is there no other option? Is there no other candidate to take on that portfolio apart from a very busy person like himself?
If I'm going to be candid, I think he took it on as a bit of a propaganda device to show that he's hands-on and that he will be able to deliver something. It's a bit double-edged, though, because if he doesn't deliver, it's going to be on his account that the food problems, price problems, agriculture problems weren't resolved. At the same time, there are such huge problems in the economy right now. Even the president's claims that agriculture is the foundation, agriculture is the primary, is of primeval importance, that's not actually true. The Philippines has a pre-industrial structure. We have to double time really on strengthening our manufacturing, Filipino industry, job creation. In the near term, we have to sort out huge problems in terms of emergency cash assistance, in terms of providing relief, dealing with the global turmoil. To have the president fixated on agriculture as if it's the be-all and end-all of solving our problems actually does not seem well advised. But again, we'll see how it plays out. Having said that, if it does lead to a real self-sufficiency approach, if it does lead to an increase in the agricultural budget and real support for domestic producers that makes prices cheaper in the future, I think that is worth supporting. But there are other problems beyond agriculture, I think, that should be attended to as well.
And the talk about cheap prices, one of the campaign promises is to lower the price of rice to 20 pesos per kilo. But a lot of people already saying that's not possible, although it's possible to go below 30 pesos under his administration. What do you make of that?
In a crude sense, 20 pesos is easily possible if the government outright subsidizes everyone's consumption of rice. From the 40 pesos right now, the retail price, if it subsidizes the balance of 20 pesos, it's about 250 billion pesos a year. He could literally do it overnight. Is that sustainable? Of course not. Over the long term, okay, we can give him the benefit of a doubt. If it's an aspirational target of 20 pesos, we hope it's 20 pesos for food self-sufficiency, not 20 pesos as a public relations gimmick to provide to just the 4P's beneficiaries or a fraction of the Philippine population. If it's going to be a propaganda gimmick just to say that, okay, we provided 20 pesos cheaply using the NFA to the poorest 4.5 million Filipino families, that leaves about 21 million families also hard up, not benefiting from that. So we hope it happens. Over the long term, it is possible with enough effort, but again, he has to balance it. And if he's so fixated in agriculture, not seeing there are resources needed for infrastructure, there are resources needed for industrial development, there are resources needed for helping MSMEs, a fixation in agriculture, I think, could very well become counterproductive if not balanced properly.
And what about the statements made by President Marcos about improving the value chain production in order to boost the agriculture sector? Although he did say yesterday that he is open to still importing, to still import rice and corn at least until December. What do you make of these pronouncements? Are we seeing a clear path forward?
In all honesty, to say that we want to improve the value chain isn't saying anything. It's just describing that there is a chain of production from the farmer to the consumer. To say that we're going to improve the value chain is actually a bit meaningless. For that to be consequential, he has to identify, will he be spending on infrastructure to help our rice farmers become more productive? How much will he be spending on making inputs more affordable? Will he be providing research and extension services? Are there going to be enough marketing support, including with public or state distribution channels? Is he going to be building the right post-harvest infrastructure, farm-to-market roads? So that statement about using the value chain, it's like throwing a fancy term around that sounds nice, but it's actually quite meaningless if you don't put any meat into it. And exactly that is our point. Since the campaign period, we have been hearing a lot of nice statements. This is an initial endorphin rush, but we're not actually seeing the hard measures necessary for that. And he even did not respond to that question properly when he was asked during the press conference.
Mm-hmm. But what can be done at this point, Sunny, with respect to agriculture and at least alleviating the rising prices of food?
Yeah, I think the most important thing is we have to get over this chronic short-termism of the government. Usually there's a big flurry of pretend attention giving to a problem like rising food prices. So we're going to hear proposals about emergency powers and things like that. I think the best thing that can be done is make the crisis an opportunity to realize we have to fix our structural problems in agriculture. We have to subsidize domestic agriculture to make it more productive. We have to defy people to say agriculture will be competitive if you leave it to free market forces. If we get over that thinking that the free market will develop agriculture, I think it's the first important step to actually improving agriculture and cheaper food down the line and self-sufficiency, like President Marcos said. But having said that, actually, their hands are tied right now. Things are so bad and so difficult, and things are so expensive precisely because of that short-termism. It's so hard to talk about developing agriculture because we've been decimating agriculture for decades. It's so hard to talk about regulating the price of oil because we have been deregulating oil for decades. It's hard to talk about price controls like Malaysia, Vietnam, and Thailand have because we've been numbed into thinking price controls are bad. So we have to roll back on that self-defeat, this thinking that the government can do anything. We have to roll back on saying that the market can solve everything. Once we fix that, then I think we can start investing in the structural problems and also giving the right relief right now that we need to give. And it's expensive. Relief is expensive because we haven't attended to the long-term problems in the past.
Mm-hmm. And talk about expensive items, like, for example, fuel prices have been really skyrocketing lately. And one of the things that President Marcos mentioned yesterday is that when it comes to inflation, some things are beyond our control. Is that really also the case with respect to fuel prices?
The global fuel prices are beyond our control. But two things within our control is how much the local oil producers, importers pass it on to consumers, which is unfortunately very opaque. It's not transparent at all. And secondly, the taxes being put on to the oil products. Oil products are a good thing to tax because you can say it's environmentally friendly. It helps raise revenues because it's price inelastic and things like that. But if, for instance, some neighboring countries are considering cutting their tax on oil products, I think that's a recognition. 100 peso diesel or gas, that's crazy. I mean, if you breach that and that lasts over a long period of time, at some point it is going to be counterproductive to rely on these market forces. So for us, we have to go back to regulating the oil industry. There were problems in the past, but fix those problems, not sort of replace it with an industry where we have no control. So in all honesty, we don't have control right now because we chose not to have control, because we bought into this hype that deregulating is a good thing, absolutely. And then we just have to rely on market forces and the, you know, the good faith of corporations, the goodwill of corporations to be honest in their pricing mechanisms. That's not really, I think, where we should be heading in the next few years.
And to what extent do you think the subsidies that the government has been giving and plans to continue giving will address this problem? President Marcos indicated yesterday that the Libreng Sakay program will continue and that students will be fully subsidized in their fares for LRT2. It's not clear yet when this will start, but do we have the money for it?
I think sort of three quick points. The subsidies would not be that big if we actually had regulated the industry to begin with. If from the very beginning, we were confident that we were moderating the price increases being passed on, the subsidies wouldn't be that big. Second point, do we have the money for that? We can have the money for that, but we have to change our thinking about the tax system. It is always a problem with any social measure where to raise the money from. I think in the case of the Philippines, with such concentrated wealth, and clearly built some, 3,000 billionaires having 8.1 trillion pesos in accumulated wealth, clearly that is a huge opportunity to expand our fiscal space. But moving beyond the traditional neoliberal free market, let's rely on consumption taxes. Third point, President Marcos said he had the biggest electoral mandate in his inaugural speech. I think that's a good starting point to start taking the bold reforms. If he thinks there's going to be opposition from billionaires for a wealth tax, he should use his mandate to push for a wealth tax because it will benefit most people with hardly any adverse effects on a few wealthy people. Same thing about any oil monopoly, same thing with any vested interests who might be affected by a self-sufficiency approach. So I think if he does claim that large a mandate, he should have the confidence to have bolder measures. That's assuming he is concerned about the social economic crisis. That's also assuming he has the vision to go beyond doing the same things that we've been doing for the last few decades that clearly have actually not been that helpful.
Mm-hmm. At this point, Sunny, do we have a clear idea now of what the economic plans of President Marcos are? Can we assess that? And based on the appointments that he has made in key economic agencies, what do you make of this?
It's actually quite interesting because if you listen to President Marcos, even that choice of the term sufficiency instead of security, that actually goes against the philosophy, economic philosophy of the economic managers. So I kind of suspect the reason he's not able, maybe part of the reason he's not able to say anything more is because he's not getting any support from his economic managers who are not believers in sufficiency, who believe more in the food security notion. But I think that also points us to where the problem lies. The economic team, of course, they're quite professional. They're very distinguished. They're all experts in their respective fields. But if you ask Ibon, I think the problem with the current economic team is precisely they're experts in a kind of economics that has not delivered. If the economy has been failing, and it has been failing, agriculture has been falling, manufacturing has been falling, job generation has been falling. The only improvements we've had are in tax generation because consumption taxes have been increased. I mean, if we rely on that same kind of thinking in the next 6 years, we will see the same problems emerging over and over again in different ways. So I think if the President Bongbong Marcos, I actually don't think he has a very strong economic vision, but if at the very least, in terms of agriculture, he breaks that old thinking, we might actually be able to salvage something from his presidency. And actually do invite, I think, the economic team to look at the last 40 years with a clearer, not so rose-colored glasses. The last 40 years have actually not been good for the majority of Filipinos. We have seen some serious economic decline over the last 40 years, worsening in the last 6 years. And I think if we don't start off from accepting that there are deep problems, we'll be repeating the same policy mistakes in the coming 6 years.
Mm-hmm. Won't there be a problem between the president and his economic managers if, as you say, there seems to be a difference in terms of thinking, in terms of philosophy, in terms of views? Do you foresee that happening, or do you think the economic managers will tend to defer to the wishes of the president?
Our fearless forecast is there's a lot of momentum to the current market-based pro-big business framework. I think that the current pro-market framework of the Philippines, it's that's been the trajectory for the last four decades. We don't think it's going to change. At most, there might be pockets of resistance, like in terms of populist measures, like what might be done with agriculture. But we don't see any rollback in liberalization, despite countries like China and the US now being more protectionist. We don't see any rollbacks in terms of the automatic debt payments policy, despite other countries pursuing debt relief to sort of give them more physical space. We are hoping that, you know, as the crisis proceeds and as we see a shifting in the global policy regime, even with the WTO, hardly anything new came out of the WTO. We're seeing a slowdown in terms of liberalization as supported by the United Nations. If that sort of rethinking of our own accustomed policies sinks in with economic managers, I think we can take some baby steps forward. It's not going to be easy, but I think we need some radical reforms really to sort of not be talking about the same problems administration after administration.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, Sunny, if you were to give an advice on which priority areas should the economic managers and President Marcos focus on, what would that be?
I would have to agree agriculture is important as a starting point, but I would add, if it is a starting point, it can't be the main lever for economic development. The main lever for economic development has to be developing Filipino industry. That's been quite proven historically. No country has ever developed from agricultural backwardness without developing their own industry. If that industry is developed with a sound industrial policy involving a good balance of protectionist measures and real support for domestic industry, I think the next 6 years can actually put us on the path towards real industrialization. But there has to be some rethinking. We have to start imposing market-defying measures, not always deferring to what liberalization advocates tend to always say. That has failed in the past in the Philippines. It has never worked in any other country in the world.
All right. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning. Ibon Foundation Executive Director, Sunny Africa.
Thanks, Mike. Good night. Good morning.